What's that?
You're trooping around.
Oh yeah. Now I have this microphone. I don't have the.
That's what it is.
That's the difference. That's why I'm screaming more at you.
Yeah.
I don't think that's what it is. I think I've always yelled at you, Aaron. I think it's.
It always surprises me though. Really?
Well, that's because you're sleeping. I have to wake you up. You're resting. That's what my dad said. I'm not sleeping. I'm resting my eyes. Although every time I grab my little son and I lay down there, he's supposed to lay down on me and I put him to sleep. I think I'm putting myself to sleep because he's so small and I'm like, okay, this is good. And I fall asleep like that. Isn't that something? He is. He is. He likes to sleep and eat and sleep and eat. So he's going to fit right in our family quite well.
That's another interesting fact.
Oh, boy.
We were talking about breast milk earlier.
Yes. We talk about everything here.
Touch. Touch is one of the most important stimulants for growth in a child. In fact,
that's interesting.
Children that are deprived of touch tend to be, they have growth development issues.
That makes a lot of sense, actually, because children need affection. The Bible says that they do. In order to grow right, they need that affection.
Yeah.
That's makes a lot of sense.
So when you say
it does, and they need that rod of correction, which is another form of love and
so,
touch.
So when you say you just don't have hugs when you're a baby, there's some truth.
Right? Are you looking for something, Dave?
Yeah.
Or is that?
By
the look on your face, I thought you did.
I forgot where I saw them, though.
That look was like a bewildered look, like, am I in the right room? It's okay, I think you're in the right place. Yeah, they're scrambled like eggs. All right. Anyway, well, amen. So we're all ready back there. And if you didn't eat too much food, you won't fall asleep. You ate too much food, we'll all know that you were the glutton today. Because you'll be the first one sleeping. You're done. But Lee can pinch your ear.
This is true.
And he can stand now.
And you can stand now.
A little bit.
And we're no, you can stand.
Quick, take his chair.
I can stand.
You can stand. I watched you. You were grilling out there, and you were standing.
And having done all to stand, stand.
Yeah.
That's right. Amen. We're. How's the therapy sessions going? Are you still doing them? Or?
I'm done with the therapy. I'm gonna try and get us into a gym.
Okay.
Over the summer, it has a pool too.
So. Yeah, because you got to continue to build your.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Plus, I'm probably gonna be able to teach my little ones.
Yeah. Yeah. Well. That's a blessing. You've come a long way with that, brother. Praise the Lord. That's right. Two hip surgeries and continuing on. And you lost a lot of weight from before. And
that shirt that I had on as a testimony, I bought that. It didn't fit.
Amen.
But I like the shirt.
So you just wanted to wear it?
Yes, I wore it. It fits me great. It's roomy.
It's roomy. Ah, I like that. All right, John chapter 16. Let's go there. We're going to get started here. We're going to talk about the Donatists. What's up?
Good,
oh, good chapter. Okay. Dave, you're concerning me over there. I'm watching you. I'm like, Dave, why are you making me so nervous? You're
just like,
oh, is that what it is? I'm like, Dave, are you okay? What are you doing over there? That's it. Becca, what'd you feed him anyway? Did you give him too much cold brew this morning or what? Probably. Anyway. We'll blame her for it. That's right. We've never done these memory verses of John 16, have we? You girls would remember. You remember everything. Let me borrow your memory. Do you remember? We haven't done those, have we? Okay, good. Well, now we're going to do them. Because I couldn't remember which if we had done those yet, but then I was thinking, I was like, no, I don't think we have. So, John chapter 16, we're going to look at the first three verses here, and that's going to go along with our teaching today. Actually, first four verses for memorization. So the little ones, get as many as you can. The older ones, you should be able to get all of them. Right? Right? Right, Micah? All of them. Right? Like you did today. Pete, you can get all of them, right? All right, good. How about the guy next to you? You think he can? He did pretty good today. Yep. Did we do 12? I don't remember that. Is he making stuff up?
I think he might be making stuff up.
What? Is he making that up? John overruled you. He said, no, that's not true. Let's have a Baptist brawl about it. All right? I don't remember that one. Okay. Well, either way, those aren't the ones we're doing. Anyway, we're doing 16, John chapter 16, verse 1 through 3. Which, 4. Thank you. 4. That's right. Thanks, Joshua. I appreciate that. These things have I spoken unto you, that you should not be offended. They shall put you out of the synagogues. Yea, the time cometh that whosoever killeth you will think that he doeth God's service. And these things will they do unto you, because they have not known the Father nor me. Now, the spirit of persecution is what we see right here. And God is warning, and I've preached on this before, but God is warning what that spirit of persecution is like. Jesus was telling you who these people are that do these things. And the way that they do them. This, of course, isn't talking about church discipline or things that are necessary to be done. But this is clear persecution, putting them out and killing them and violence, right? Like we saw from men like Ulrich Zwingli, the Protestant reformer. Like we saw from other men like Calvin, who had Michael Servetus put to death. Right? He had him put to death. Like you saw from many of the reformers that did some of those things. You know, there's some speculation as far as Luther goes, so I always want to add that in there because there is some speculation as to a few things. But I will say this, though, that Luther told those princes that when the Munster Uprising happened, that those there was a group of those Munster men, from what I understand, that I know, they sound like the Monster Men, I know, but there was a group of those men that they got violent and started doing a bunch of other things, they say. But when you study the spirit of Anabaptism or those Anabaptists, what you find is that that's not even a part of their life at all. But anyway, so we'll leave that one alone. But I will say this, that there were a lot of those Protestant reformers that got their truth, got their teachings from Rome. And this is the spirit that they had. And that's why I'm teaching you, that's one of the reasons I'm teaching you Baptist history, so you understand that Baptists never had the spirit to persecute others. They were always the persecuted for the faith. They never lifted up their sword to persecute others for what they believed. They never wanted to take the state and use it as a weapon to hurt other people in what they believed. That doesn't mean they agreed with what those other people believed, because they didn't. In fact, you're going to hear the Donatists, how this is the sword that the Donatists would use. Amen. They would come out with this because they knew that this is mightier than any sword that a civil magistrate could ever use. That this sword is one that cuts through to the heart. It either pricks the heart or it cuts the heart. When it cuts it, it severs it, and they're reprobate and they die and go to hell. When it pricks it pricks it that they might be saved. Amen. that they might So you study the difference in cutting and pricking in the scriptures, and you'll notice that the cutting is the cut it off, it's the severing of it's bad. Yep. It's bad when you look at things that are like that. It's not a good thing when people are cut to the heart like that. They're persecutors. They're the ones that kill people. Yep. And think they do God's service. Look what it says here. They shall put you out of the synagogues. Yea, the time cometh that whosoever killeth you will think that he doeth God service. They are completely, if you could convince a man that God is on his side and God is okay with him murdering people for the faith, then you'll get that man to kill anybody. And they're all religious that do it. Adolf Hitler was a very religious man. He was the son of the Roman Catholic Church. He was a very religious man. A lot of people don't know that about him. But he absolutely was. He modeled his entire SS after the Jesuits. His entire Secret Service was modeled after the Jesuits. All Secret Service is modeled after the Jesuits today. All espionage, all of those things are modeled after the Jesuits. They're modeled after that Secret Service, the SS, and all of those other things. So they all have a religion, right? They all have a form of godliness, but they deny the power thereof. And you know what spirit they have by what they want to do. I mean, our goal is, people don't like the fact that we preach against homosexuality, the sodomites. We preach against the LGBTQ and all those other things. And we preach against all fornication, all those other things, all the sins that the Lord has told us to preach against. And they don't like that because they think that it's mean or it's intolerable or it's this or it's that. Well, the difference between us and them is we don't want to kill anybody. Right. See, they want to kill babies. See, I make it very clear what their position is. Like, I'm not running for office. I'm not a politician. I make it very clear. You people want to murder babies. Yep. So forgive me if I don't take my lessons in compassion and understanding from people that openly go into clinics and have the brains of their babies sucked out. Or they sell their body parts to make money. Right, so you'll forgive me if I don't take my morality and my sense of morality and all of that from those people. Right. No, what we do is we take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, and we slash with that. And that makes them want to kill us. Right. Do you understand that? Let me be very clear with you. That's what makes them want to kill us. Not because we go out and get an army together and go shoot people and kill them and want to fight them and we want to chop the heads off of sodomites and everything else. No, we don't want to do any of that. We want to see them saved. Listen, friend, whatever they do in this life is nothing compared to what's coming for them. Amen. What's coming for them is hell and damnation for all of eternity in the judgment of God. That's way worse than anything that they can do in this life. That's their judgment. So what they hate the most is the spirit of this book. That's why they want to kill us. And that's why they want to kill the Donatists. That's the reason. These ancient Baptist people were the same way. Or should I say we were the same as them. Are the same as them in that sense. Now we live in a bubble of kind of... I would say impracticality or something of that nature. What I mean by that is that, like, it's not common all over the world to be able to preach the gospel, to be able to assemble like we do here, and to be able to do those things without people trying to kill you. Your brethren over in China are being slaughtered like dogs every day. They're being slaughtered like you slaughter chickens and hogs. Every day, all over the world, right? In all those countries, right? So you have to understand, we live in this bubble of difference here because of men like these ancient Baptists, men that God used to help form. If you haven't heard, go listen to my broadcast I did last week on Friday. I talked about John MacArthur and how he's wrong about religious liberty, and it was a really good rant, actually. So we really need to separate that. We need to edit that, Luke or Andrew. We need to edit that. And get that on a separate file and put that up. It really needs to be. I want people to understand that. And because, see, we understand why religious liberty matters. Amen. And why we believe in religious liberty for that Muslim over there. I believe he ought to have religious liberty too. Why is that? Well, I can't preach the gospel to him. How's he ever going to get saved? Yep. Right? See, if everyone has religious liberty, I know what happens if you pick and choose a flavor of religious liberty that you're okay with. Then the next time the guy's in charge that hates what you stand for, he's going to cut your head off. See, that's how that works.
Like American politics has become.
Yeah, that's how that works. And that's why you have to have a right understanding of religious liberty. But a lot of people don't understand the founding of America. They believe the stories that people like David Barton tell them, and even people that I like, Chris Pinto. I like a lot of his history. I've got a lot of his videos, and they're really good to a point. But he's missing something. What's he missing? He doesn't understand Rhode Island. He doesn't understand that lively experiment. He doesn't understand John Leland. He doesn't understand the Leland Madison Memorial. He doesn't understand what took place.
Liberty
he doesn't.
Of conscience.
Yeah, he doesn't understand liberty of conscience. Well, why? Because he's a reformer, and they just don't get it.
No.
Most of them don't get it. They don't get it. They believe as long as the church is in charge of the state, then everything's going to be great. Well, look at the history of how that worked out in England. And then in Puritan New England. Didn't work out good for Baptists or Quakers. Yeah, but Quakers are heretics. Yeah, I know they are, but I don't want their heads chopped off.
Even nonconformist
preachers. Right. So, see, that's the kind of history lessons that you're going to get with this. I'm going to give you those extra little history lessons of things so you understand them very, very well. You might wonder, well, I can't believe that you'd believe in religious liberty for somebody that preaches a false gospel. Well, here's the thing. When Jesus was there, and when those men came to him and they said, Lord, should we now call down fire from heaven and have these consumed? Should we call down fire from heaven and just kill them all, God? Should we just get rid of all of them? He just said, you know not what manner of spirit you're of. Jesus, I didn't come to condemn men. I didn't come to kill men. I came to save them. Right? How can they hear unless a preacher goes and preaches them? And you ain't going to hear nothing if you're dead.
Yep.
Right.
Come on.
Amen.
Right?
Pretty simple.
That's right. That's not the Great Commission. That's like the Great Omission.
Yep.
Right? You're just going to kill people.
That's
exactly what that is, and it's wrong. So Baptists have understood that down, and by the way, I would say Baptists as opposed to the last 100 years, before that they understood it. Baptists
right.
now have been so indoctrinated with Protestant doctrine, and they are so far removed from their roots of understanding of how this country was formed, they don't even know. They don't, like, your average Baptist doesn't even know why they even go to a Baptist church or why they're called a Baptist. They don't have any clue why. They have no idea. They just think it's like a title that they use. Right. They have no idea why. So then they don't like ministries like this because we do draw the lines and make distinctions and be like, nope, this is why. Because see, that's why I don't let people like Johnny Mack and all those other guys talk me down with their nonsense and their foolishness and any of those reformers like that. Why? Because I know the history. I can show it to them. I can stand them and look them right in their eyes and be like, okay, I'll show you. You want to see it? Let me show you separation of church and state. I'll show it to you.
Amen.
And I'll show you why. So then you don't have a Constantine in charge that ends up choosing who the winners and losers are. Right? People are very ignorant of that. And Baptists don't teach their history any longer. They just stop teaching their history. All right. The warm-up. Was the warm-up. Take my red pen out there. All right, now we're going to get into David Benedict's book here. And, I should finish this. Verse number 3, and these things will they do unto you because they have not known the Father nor me. Boy, that's pretty clear, isn't it?
Yep.
Wait, so God says if they kill you and they think they do God's service, it's because they don't know me?
Uh-oh.
Or the Father?
They're lost. Not brothers.
See?
I'm not going to call you my brother.
Right.
Yep. Match up with you.
See? Every word matters, doesn't it?
Right.
Every word. Every word. But these things have I told you, that when the time shall come, you may remember that I told you of them. And these things I said not unto you at the beginning, because I was with you. Let's pray. Father, Lord, help us as we go through. We learn about this history, Lord. Help us to apply these important things to our lives and our hearts. And Lord, to take with us this history and this rich heritage that we have, and to move forward in the faith, walking in the fear of the Lord, and connecting our children to their rich heritage they have. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. See, one of the reasons why we do this too is so our children understand our history.
Amen.
So they're not one of those kids that grow up and say, well, you go to a Baptist church, well, I'll just go to the other church down the road. What's the difference? We're all the same. No, we're not.
Come on.
We're not all the same. And by the way, it's not a contention for name, it's a contention for doctrine.
That's right.
The name could never be shaken, though.
Right.
There was a reason that name couldn't be shaken. In whatever form it was, it just couldn't be. Why? Because it all centered around the proper order. Salvation first. Blood before water. Let me say it again to you. Blood before water. That's what makes a Baptist. Blood before water. The blood of Christ before water baptism. That's what was the differentiation between all of those sects that were back there and all of those groups that were back there. Blood before water. And it was the contention that these men had. All right, so we're going to get into the persecution of the Donatists here. From the death of Constantine the Great to the reign of Julian the Apostate was a period of about a quarter of a century, during which Constantine II, Constantinius, and Constans, sons of the founder of the dynasty, occupied the imperial throne. Of none of these reigns, so far as the Donatists were concerned, do I find so much information as that of Constans, under whose administration of the empire occurred the Macarian War, accounts of which will occupy a considerable portion of this chapter. So this Macarian or Macarian War, this Macarian War was a war against the Donatists. And this war was when they used the government to go after the Donatists and their churches and to persecute them and to kill them and to steal their buildings and their meeting houses and all those other things and to take them in the name of reuniting them to the Roman Catholic or to the Catholic Church, which would have been the Roman, basically morphing into the Roman Catholic Church. So to bring them back to what they would consider the Catholic faith. So that's what a lot of this is going to cover today. Although it is said that Constans at first did not seem disposed to engage in severe measures against the Donatists to force them back into the church, yet under him, in the end, this people were most severely persecuted. After Constantine the Great, the Roman Empire was divided into two parts, which were called the Eastern and Western, from their geographical positions. The western portion, in which North Africa was included, fell to Constans, who, says Neander, instead of forcible measures in the early part of his reign, simply employed those means which were then frequently resorted to on the part of the court for the purpose of making proselytes. So, in other words, basically, what you're going to hear is they tried to buy him off first. They offered him big money and big prizes. But that didn't work because the Donatists were like, well, no, we're not going to take your money. We don't want your money. We want our churches to be autonomous. We want them to be separate. In the year 340, the emperor directed his two commissioners, Eraschius and Leonidas, to endeavor by the distribution of money under the name of alms to win over the Donatist churches. And as the said emperor at the same time issued an edict whereby he called upon the North African Christians to return back to the unity of the church, which Christ loved, it was the less possible that the object of these measures should remain concealed from the Donatist bishops. So, in other words, basically, Constans came in as the emperor and he started doling out cash to the churches to get them to reunite. It almost sounds like Trump's PPP loans. Uh-oh. It almost sounds like that. Like it more than almost sounds like it. It's like a dead ringer. Okay, but it was what? They paid them money to reunite. They made life easy on them. Right? So some of these, like recently, and I've talked about this before, but it's funny that I'm on this, that we are on this right now during this time in American history of what's going on. Because you literally have the former administration, which, by the way, back in 2015, if you remember that video I did with, 17, 2017 with Greg Dixon, I said, is Trump the next Constantine? That was before any of that happened. And what happened? He gave money to all the churches that wanted it. All of them that had a staff were able to, they were able to apply for that money. And some of those churches got anywhere, well, what's recorded is anywhere from $50,000 that you can get access to easily up to $3 million. These churches got from the Trump administration. Yeah, they had to be nonprofit organizations. They had to have 501c3 status. They had to have employees, and they had to run like a business. Which, to give you a refresher course, we have none of those things. Right? We won't do any of that stuff. We don't have a tax identification number. We don't have a nonprofit status. We don't have an ink, except the ink in this pen. Right? And I'm not even an employee of Old Paths Baptist Church. Because the people of this church gift their pastor whatever he gets.
Amen.
I don't have a salary, right? We don't have a, it's not in my contract. Where's my contract? Where is my paid vacation? Oh, wait.
God pays for your vacation.
Yes, he does. And no overtime. Right, Brother Paul? No overtime pay. My health insurance, my. But you know, I want for nothing. Amen.
Amen.
Why is that? Because God's faithful.
Amen.
God's faithful. And we also didn't let them give us hush money, so we kept ourselves closed.
That's right. That's right.
Interesting. And by the way, by the grace of God, you didn't see us get on. And I see these Baptist pastors that are running these big colleges, and they're literally crying online. They're crying online and begging the state to let them open. Please let us open. We just want to preach. Don't do this and don't. And they're like, they're literally crying. And I'm like, well, why didn't you just do it? Like, why didn't you just do it? Well, I know why. Because you signed an agreement in the health department, and you signed up for, and you said that you agreed with public, that you would abide by public policy. What, say that again?
And not preach against it.
Yeah. Right, and not preach against public policy, and that you would, I mean, those were all things that you agreed to when you signed your corporate papers. And that's why they, like, you'll notice that we don't have a sticker outside there saying, mask up. Right? You don't see that. You know, mask up, it's the law. Well, no, it's not. But anyway, it's actually not the law. The law is passed by the House and the Senate and signed by the governor, and that never happened. So that's a decree from the emperor. It's not a law. It's a decree. Yeah, yeah. So that there's a difference in that. But anyway, so all of those things, they tried. See, nothing new under the sun, right? They tried that with the Donatists. I know. We'll just give them some money. And if we give them some money, then they'll listen to us. Then they'll come back home to the mother church, and we'll just all get along again. Right? Like Rodney King in L.A. Some of you won't get that. You're not old enough. Paul gets it, don't you, Paul? Do you remember that? You don't get that, do you? You were probably even alive then, were you? I believe that. All right. Do you remember that?
I remember.
What's that?
They gave Reginald Denny some
wild. Yeah, they did give it. They dropped some democracy on it, didn't they? Oh, anyway, I'm sorry. Okay. All right. On the failure of this covert scheme for gaining the Donatists, forcible measures were the next resort. Okay, well, the money's not working. All right, in come the big guns now. That's what happens. Okay, well, we can't get them to listen to us. If we pay them off, They won't take our money, so now we're going to force them. That was the next thing. See, that's one of Satan, that's one of the things that Satan tries. He uses bribery and flattery, right? He uses that, which we're going to get to. We'll talk about that a little bit. And then when he can't do that, then he uses the force of the sword and the gun and death, basically. Yeah. Yeah. If you just bow, he'd give you everything you wanted. If thou wilt fall down and worship me, right? On the failure of this conference, that's what happened. The Donatists now were to be deprived of their churches. So they weren't allowed to assemble. They weren't allowed to have buildings to meet in. Now, all right, we tried to pay you and you didn't want our money, so now you can't assemble together, and now you can't have a building, and now you can't meet as a church anywhere. And they were actually fallen upon by armed troops while assembled in them for the worship of God. Wait, you mean these good, nice Catholic brethren? By the way, that's why I still live under that Baptist motto of no truce with Rome.
Amen.
I still live under that. Like, I don't believe it. Like, this Pope that looks like this nice little socialist guy that walks around, everybody thinks he's a great guy, that guy's a devil. He is an absolute devil. Francis, yeah.
He'd order execution in a heartbeat.
Oh, sure he would. He worships the earth. He's a pagan. He's a Jesuit. I mean, he's a devil, and everybody thinks he's a pretty nice guy. While he's meeting with transgenders and bringing them into the Catholic Church and everything else, well, they're just coming out of the closet. They've always been there, but
right.
You don't need to. Yeah, telling America that they shouldn't have a wall around their border, but he's got a wall and a moat around the Vatican. You losers! You don't need a wall, you losers. Yeah, what's the matter with you guys? And then he talks about the capitalist pigs and how everybody's like a capitalist pig. I love it. And then he's over there and he's got more money than anybody. He's worth like trillions. Wait a minute. You have your own castle, a bunch of them, and you have all the land that you stole from all those people you killed over the years and their fortunes that you robbed them from.
They're basically a conglomerate.
Oh, absolutely they are. A huge one. So, this is who they are. Hence followed the effusion of blood and the martyrdoms of which the Donatists so often complained of their adversaries. Those who fell victims in these persecutions, says Neander, were honored by their party as martyrs, and the annual celebration of the days of their death furnished new means of enkindling the enthusiasm of the Donatist party. In the times under consideration, Gradius had succeeded Cecilian as the Bishop of Carthage. Both he and the Emperor Constantinus, says Robinson, persecuted the Donatists with great severity. Because this group of Donatist churches would not conform back into the Catholic Church, because they wouldn't, they persecuted them. At an early period, this persecuted people entirely renounced the church and state policy, and of course said, "What was the emperor to do with the church?" was their reply to the offers of royal bounty. We say the same thing. What does the Emperor Walls have to do with the church? What does the President of the United States have to do with the church? What does Congress have to do with the church? I know nothing.
Amen.
Nothing. It's not their place to pick and choose winners. It's their place to leave them alone. The evil spirit before openly combated in the church, said they, was now a still more dangerous enemy in its covert attacks, since it made pretext of religion itself and strove to insinuate itself in men's hearts by flattery. So see, here's the thing. What they used was flattery to get their way in. They would flatter people with money and coercion and try to force them. But that is the devil's tactic. That's what the devil does. That's how he operates. Let's look at some of those scriptures. Let's see. Psalm 36. Verse number 2, for he flattereth himself in his own eyes until his iniquity be found to be hateful. That's the work of the devil right there. Proverbs 6:24. Look what the Bible warns us about. By the way, the strange woman is a picture of a false church. There's two meanings there. There is a strange woman for your son not to marry a strange woman, which means that's a woman that is not saved by the grace of God, walking in the fear of the Lord. But it's also that strange woman is a type of a false religion. It is the Roman Catholic Church. That's what it is. Same picture. To keep thee from the evil woman, from the flattery of the tongue of a strange woman. Right? Amen. Same thing. Proverbs 7, who talks about that strange woman? Verse number 15, excuse me. Actually, I think that's the wrong verse. Maybe it is 5. Yep, it is 5. That's a good one too, though. That they may keep thee from the strange woman, from the stranger which flattereth with her words. And verse number 21, with her much fair speech she caused him to yield. With the flattering of her lips she forced him. See, that's, turn to Daniel chapter 11. That's Satan's MO. That's what he does. He uses flattery to get what he wants, to seduce people. Daniel chapter 11, verse number 21. And in his estate shall stand up a vile person. This is talking about the end times, the Antichrist. And in his estate shall stand up a vile person to whom they shall not give the honor of the kingdom. But he shall come in peaceably and obtain the kingdom by flatteries. Verse number 32. And such as do wickedly against the covenant shall he corrupt by flatteries. But the people that do know their God shall be strong and do exploits. That's us. Amen. Always do exploits against the kingdom of Antichrist. And they that understood among the people shall instruct many, yet they shall fall by the sword and by the flame and by captivity and by spoil many days. Who knows what the Lord will allow to happen, right? Amen. Now when they shall fall, they shall be hoping with a little help, but many shall cleave to them with flatteries. Isn't that what's happening in these end times? That's what they're doing, cleaving with flatteries. They're using flattery. And some of them of understanding shall fall. By the way, that's to save people. Some are going to fall. Some are going to be tricked. But listen to what God says about them. To try them. God's not doing it to destroy them. He's doing it to try them. Because God's children never finally fall into apostasy. But he tries them and to purge and to make them white, even to the time of the end, because it is yet for a time appointed. God's going to let some fall and be tricked and deceived for a while, but he's going to bring them up again. Amen? God's going to make sure they're not deceived that greatly. Now, the next portion here is the Macarian War that took place against the Donatists in 347. This followed the unsuccessful experiments with the royal bounty, which was rejected by the Donatists. And this is the only case among all severe persecutions of this people of which we have any detailed accounts. And in this case, all the reputed facts are from the pen of Optatus, who had no records, but related what he had heard. And when the Donatists objected to only hearsay news, he retorted that it was all they had themselves. But unhappily for the Donatists, nothing from them direct has been preserved. Why is that? Because they burned them. The reason why people ask, well, listen, where are all the great Baptist writings from history? In ashes. Because they burned them. As soon as they found their library, the first thing they did was burn their books. Why? Because they didn't want people, they knew that if men read, men would grow. If women read, they would grow. If children read, they would grow. Right, and they didn't have printing presses, that's right. They had, their libraries were on scrolls. Right? Yeah, goat skins and all those other, that's where their writings were. They didn't have what we have. They couldn't print a book that fast. We could do it in minutes. What took them days to write out, you know, to have it all ready and everything? And they burned them. Right? They burned them. So that's why they're direct. That's why Baptists, we trace our history. Remember this. I'll say it again to you. We trace our history through our enemies' writings. That's how you find Baptist history. You find it through their enemies' writings because they wrote about them. And most of the time they said, you know, they really were a pious people. It was a shame we had to kill them. They were good workers. They were good citizens. They really were good in the kingdom and everything. But we just had to kill them. Why? Well, because they wouldn't worship the king. They wouldn't sacrifice to the gods of the land. They wouldn't do all those things, so we just had to kill them. But they were good people. They would always say things like that. And then the others would accuse us of, like, eating our children or something weird, but whatever. It's just kind of weird, but they would say that. Like, they ate their kids. What do you mean? When you read that stuff, you got to look at it twice. Like, what are these people talking about? Right? Those people eat their children. Then you find out who really does that. They're the witches that do those things. And they're also the same ones that stick those vaccines in your arms from aborted fetal cells and everything else, and they want you to take that. That would actually mean, like, that they actually do that. So, like, when they accuse us of correcting our children, that's child abuse, and they accuse us of all those other things like that, only their way is, just kill it when it's a baby, and then you don't have to worry about it, and then use its body parts to make money off of. Right? I know, that's blunt. A lot of preachers don't like to talk that blunt, but it needs to be said. It needs to be said, because we should be offended by that. We should be like, that's terrible. See, I don't watch movies. I just read the Bible and show you. I just show you the actual, like, what's happening. Like, this is real. This is real life world. Yeah, this isn't fantasy land. This is, like, really happening. This is what this world is coming to, right? And it was then for them. But unhappily for the Donatists, nothing from them direct has been preserved. Almost the whole of the third book or chapter of Optatus is occupied with the war under consideration. So he's going to talk about the war here. Moschim, which is another good history, he was a Lutheran historian. He had a lot of good things to say. Moschim's history is, number one, it's hard to find. And I do have that set, which I'm thankful for. I'm going through it. But Moschim, he wrote about the Donatist schism, they called it. And he wrote extensively about it. He was a Lutheran historian, but he was a very good one. I mean, he was a very good historian. That doesn't mean they always liked us, because, I mean, they didn't. But according to Moschim, after the repulse of the Macarius with the royal bounties, he no longer used the soft voice of persuasion, but that of authority. And from what was said by Optatus, we may infer he appointed a time for his coercive policy, and as the news spread abroad, thousands collected to witness the operation. So he started to kill them, basically. The scene to be described was in the town of Bagne in the province of Numidia, a place distinguished for the number of Donatists from the first. As Macarius was without a military force, he sought one of Count Sylvester, from whom he obtained a company of armed horsemen who came equipped with the death-dealing arms of the age, that is, quivers filled with arrows. So imagine this. You're all sitting here. You're singing Worship the King, right? You're singing And Can It Be, right? You're singing all this, and you get a knock on the door. Well, not really a knock. They kick the door in, right? And they basically have poisonous arrows, or we'll just say guns, pointing at your head right now and saying that they want to kill you if you don't reunite with them and if you don't worship God according to the way that they say you should worship God. For what you're doing right now is why they invaded those Donatists, their meeting houses and their places of worship, and killed them. That's why. That's why they did it. That was their reason. Like, it wasn't because they were bad citizens and they killed people or they were evil people. No, it was because they're doing what you're doing right now. Right? That's the reason. As the business on hand was not the work of a day, this military company must be provided with quarters and supplies. Concerning these, no small difficulty was encountered both from the magistrates and the citizens. The eventful and fearful crisis has arrived. Macarius, surrounded with his military aid, proclaimed the Catholic Union. In other words, he commanded the Donatists to go into the Catholic Church, unite with them in worship, and adopt the Catholic faith. So imagine that if you're sitting right now and that priest came in with an army of people and that's what he said. Well, of course, most of you, I'm hoping all of you, would say no, right? You're like, no, I don't think so. Then said Optatus to the Donatist Bishop Parmenian, "You all ran away. You were all in fear and fled with precipitation and alarm." Then again said he, "The words of the psalmist were verified by you. They were in fear where no fear was." Now, let's stop there for a second because I want to defend Parmenian here. Now, he's making fun of Parmenian, the Donatist bishop, and he's saying, "Well, you were in fear where there was no fear to be had." Wait a minute. You guys are pointing poisonous arrows at their children and their families' faces, and you're telling them, like, you're basically walking up to them and going, "Okay, worship this Catholic church the way that we tell you to." Or better yet, they're doing it like this. But then you're telling him that he has no reason to be afraid. "Oh, you guys ran." Well, what were they supposed to do? They weren't going to kill you. They had no weapons. They weren't armed. They were sitting in church. So what'd they do? They ran. What were they supposed to do? This isn't Rambo. But he's making fun of them because he's like, "Oh, you guys all ran." "Wherefore your bishops and their clergy all fled away and some were killed." So you're admitting it. So see, he's admitting it. Yeah, some of them were killed. We killed them. And that's something you're like bragging about? That's what they were bragging about. They're bragging about killing those people. "The more resolute and robust fled far away where they were captured and afterwards were sent into exile." What does that mean? Well, they would exile them without any weapons, without any way to defend themselves against animals or beasts or anything else, right? And they would send them out. And when you exiled people like that, basically it was a death sentence. It's like you're a coward. You're not willing to stick a bullet in their head right there in front of you. You send them off into the wilderness somewhere where they have no protection, so they starve to death and die. Or they're killed by an animal. That's what exile meant. That's what they did to Roger Williams when he was over in New England. They exiled him. The Puritans did. John Cotton and all those guys, they exiled Roger Williams and John Clark and those men. They exiled them out of Massachusetts, wasn't it? Yeah, Massachusetts. He said, "Nope, you go." They sent him to the wilderness of New Hampshire. That's a terrible place to be, isn't it, brother? I've been to New Hampshire. The place is terrible. A lot of bad memories in New Hampshire. I see why it was so bad on them. I'm just kidding. But it's a beautiful place, right? But not in the middle of winter when you're freezing and you're not accustomed to that area. And that's what they did. It was like a death sentence to send them out there. So that's what they did to him, though. "The current language of historians and in their descriptions of this assault upon the Donatists represents them as being a party to the war, whereas it was a war against them, not with them. They weren't fighting a war." You understand something? The Macarian War wasn't the Donatists fighting the Catholics. No, it was the Catholics using an army to slaughter the Donatists. There wasn't a fight there. Yeah, there wasn't like they weren't trying to fight them. They were trying to run from them. They were trying not to fight. They didn't have any reason to kill these people. They wanted them to be saved. A people let's see, entirely against the idea of their fighting. Yeah, so they weren't fighting in their own defense. That's not what was happening. A people who suffer persecution but do not persecute was their stereotyped and cherished motto. The character for their community they everywhere proclaimed, and against everything warlike or coercive in religious concerns or with religious people, they most earnestly contended. So what they say, no, we don't spread the faith by the sword. They contended for that. That no, we won't force anybody to believe what we believe. And we don't believe that they ought to be harmed and hurt for any reason at all for what they believe. Accepting in their defense of church purity against the lax and corrupt system of the Catholics, there was no point on which they were more at variance with Augustine than on his coercive and persecuting policy. Nowhere in all church history can be found a more non-resisting people under the assaults of their enemies except by arguments. They always took the Bible and they always took it and they made it their argument. And they warred with them in the spirit against their religious persecutors. See, so people lift up Augustine, and for the life of me, I can't figure out why people like that philosophical nut job. I cannot figure out why anybody likes that guy. I like Spurgeon and all these other guys, and I get it, and I love them, and I listen to I've read their sermons, but I cannot for the life of me understand why anybody would like Augustine. I can't get why anybody would like Origen. Perverted weirdo. I cannot believe anybody likes those guys. They were the biggest, meanest, nastiest people ever. And they lift them up like they were just these great people, like Augustine. Isn't that the city of God, Jacob? Isn't that Augustine, right? The city on the hill, right? That was where they get that idea from. That's where you see these people like Peter Marshall and those other guys and David Barton and those guys in their history. That's the direction they tend to lean with all those things. Dominion theology. Right, of which I completely reject. Because the Donatists here, they dealt with Augustine. They knew what he was like. Tried to steal their churches, and when he couldn't do that, he tried to steal their lives. They were treated as rebels by Macarius, and his mission and policy were to bring them into the Catholic Church, peaceably if he could, forcibly if he must. Now, where in history have we heard of another general that was hired to do that? Or that volunteered to do that? Saul did it. Yep. But where else do we hear in history after this of a general that rose up to bring back these people to the mother church? Ignatius of Loyola, the Jesuits. That's Ignatius. He was the counter-reformation. What was it do? To destroy and to put down the Reformation. And by the way, the best thing about the Reformation was the Bible. The King James Bible is the bulwark of the Reformation. And that's why Baptists praise God for the Reformation. That's the only thing we praise God for about the Reformation, pretty much. Everything else was like, okay, we're going to kill the Anabaptists. But anyway, that happened a lot to them. But we do praise God for that bulwark, that grand bulwark of the Reformation, the King James Bible. Amen? We do hold that in absolute high regard. And we know that God uses many different situations, and he used that. By the way, one of the translators of the King James Bible persecuted Anabaptists when they were in prison. That doesn't make me love the King James Bible any less, because it wasn't their book; it's God's. Right? Amen. I'm not. It's not the King James Bible's not based off of King James either.
No.
King James was the king that God used, because God uses kings. The heart of the king is in God's hand. Amen. Yeah, absolutely. So I'm not confused about any of that. I understand how they treated Baptists and the Anabaptists. I think it was Sir Lancelot Andrews, wasn't it? Who was a brilliant man, by the way. Never understand it. But anyway. If, said Augustine, Macarius was unduly severe on the Donatists and went beyond the Christian law for dealing with heretics, he had recourse to the law of the king, that he should fight for the Catholic Union. I do not say, said he, that Macarius did nothing wrong, But your doings were much worse than his against the Catholics through all Africa. So listen to this. So here's what, let me finish that thought here. Say no more, brethren, of Macarian times. So far as our men were cruel, their acts were highly displeasing to us. End quote by Augustine. So what was he saying there? Basically was, look, you Donatist heretics are causing trouble everywhere with your doctrine, and you're harder on the Catholics than anybody else because of your doctrine. You've done more to hurt the Catholic Church. So what that we rose up an army and shot poisonous arrows at your people and killed all the Donatists, tried to steal their churches, take their buildings away from them and not let them assemble? That's nothing compared to you preaching false doctrine or disunity. In fact, they didn't even accuse him of preaching false doctrine. They accused him of disunity. That's what they accused him of. See how that works? See how they say that actually with a straight face? But by the way, that's why these reformers all thought it was okay to take the sword, and if you didn't agree with them, well, then they're gonna drop some religion on you. By the sword. That's what Calvin did, that's what Zwingli did. That's what John Knox did. Boy, he really hated Anabaptists, man. Knox really hated it. That's why I have no love for those people. There's no love lost for those men at all. No, I don't want to see their statues. Yeah, the Presbyterians got away with a lot in persecution, and those Puritans did. From that standpoint, so I mean, I understand. Do I read after a lot of these men? Yeah, I like to know what they said about us. But I also like to know, some of their things are really good too, by the way. A lot of historical information, a lot of things in there. I've read a lot of stuff by people I disagree with. And by the way, not every Puritan was a persecutor either. And not every Presbyterian was a persecutor. Not all of those men were. A lot of those men were good men. A lot of them were nonconformist men. They were persecuted right along with the Baptists. So we can't forget about those men too. They weren't, so don't paint every single person. We wouldn't want them doing that to us.
Right.
Don't paint all the Puritans like that, all the Calvinists like that, because they weren't all like that. There was a lot of them that weren't like that. So you got to make sure you have a right perspective of that, because otherwise you can get very tainted and then accuse people of things they never did or they never believed in. We wouldn't like that about us, so we don't want to do that to them either. Amen? Be fair about that. And be charitable when it comes to that. Dupin repeats a long list of the apologies of Optatus for Macarius' treatment of the Donatists. See, they tried to make excuses. Optatus argued that the killing of the Donatists by Macarius in his war against them for heresy was sanctioned by Moses, killing 3,000 for worshiping the golden calf. Not even close to rightly dividing. I mean, wait. First of all, the Donatists... The Catholics never accused the Donatists of worshiping a false god. I mean, we can start there. They never accused them of that. They said the only difference they had was matters in ordination, baptism, and church order. That's the difference they had. It wasn't, at that time, those that fell under the Catholic doctrine at that time, they didn't believe a false gospel. Most of them believed the true gospel. That did not come about at that time yet, where that was heavy. Now, there would have been different groups that would have, but as a whole, their doctrines were they agreed. The thing that separated them was their doctrine of the church. By the way, let me tell you something. The thing that separates this church from many others is the doctrine we hold to concerning the church. That distinctly Baptist doctrine is what, and what I would say biblical doctrine in that sense, it distinguishes us from other churches. There's an order. There's a discipline. There's ordinances. There's a proper way that we do things. All those things are found in the scriptures, and they do matter. And God holds them in high regard and of importance. Okay, so he said that Moses killing the 3,000 for worshiping the golden calf and Phinehas and Elijah for those they killed. So, hey, we can do it. Macarius, said Optatus, did not persecute like the heathen emperors who whose policy was to drive the Christians out of their churches, while that of Macarius was to drive the Donatists into the Catholic churches, where they might worship God together in the spirit of peace and unity. That's sweet. You see the hypocrisy with that? Both are just as damaging. See, here's the thing. They were comparing their persecution to the emperors that wholesale slaughtered people. They weren't, the Catholics weren't slaughtering the Donatists at the time that bad. But one, isn't one death enough? Isn't one too much? Right? But the thing is, it wasn't the same thing as torturing them and doing the things that they were doing, what the Jesuits would do later and those other groups. So they compared it. Brethren, that's why it's important for us not to compare ourselves to the world and to other groups and to other people, but to the scriptures, like we talked about, to the fullness of the stature of Christ. We're not allowed to, we're not as bad as the world. Yeah. Well, we're not as bad as these guys. We're not as bad as that church, or we're not as bad. No, our measuring stick is Christ. So it's not like we don't measure ourselves by comparing ourselves among ourselves is not wise. Because dirt comparing yourself to dirt, still dirt. Amen. Right? It's like comparing that fallen nature to one another. Well, which one's worse? Well, it depends on which perspective you're looking at. If you're looking at me, then you think I am. If I'm looking at you, then I think you are. Right? But when we look in that perfect law of liberty, we realize, man, we're all pretty bad.
Yep.
Good thing Christ is very good.
Amen.
Amen. I may have to. I would tease you and act like I'd be done, but I think I'm going to finish this. I really do. Is that terrible? How long did I preach this morning, Luke?
30 minutes.
Is that it? Okay.
You're
going to want your money back for this. You're going to be like, this is too long. What's that? I had a 15, 20 minute rant this morning.
We still have 3.5 hours till our shift is over anyway.
Your shift's not over yet. That's right.
3.5 hours.
Okay. We'll keep going then. The following remarks are from the Protestant writers. The opinion of Mosheim of the measures now under consideration is expressed in the following terms. During the troubles with the Donatists in the reign of the Emperor Constans, several steps were taken against the people which the equitable and impartial will be at a loss to reconcile with the dictates of humanity and justice. So Mosheim is saying that the Donatists had some very good complaints. Like they charged their oppressors with persecuting them and killing them. And, I mean, they had a point because they did. That's what he was saying. They had a pretty good point. That's what they were doing. And it was hard for these historians to deny that. They couldn't do that. Relative to the measures of Macarius and also those of other imperial commissioners who sought to convert the Donatists to the Catholic faith, a remark of Neander will doubtless properly apply. He said this, "It cannot be exactly determined," says he, "how much in all that was done proceeded from the imperial edicts and how much from the despotism, the passion, or the cruelty of the individual commanders." Yeah. That's why it's very dangerous to legislate, civil government to legislate religious affairs like that. Because the people that they put in charge of that can be very vicious and evil and human nature. So when anytime civil government makes a law that they understand this, every law that comes, whether it's Obamacare, whether it doesn't matter what it is, any law that comes into place, any law whatsoever, it is always enforced by the edge of the sword. Give me an example. Well, your property taxes. Are my property taxes. Wow, are they high. Anyway, but those, right? Those are enforced by the edge of a sword. Like, you say, no, they're not. Well, yes, they are. Because guys with guns will come in one day if you don't pay them. A sheriff with a badge will say, okay, your land. And he's got a gun. right? The IRS is all armed up, and they bought, like, I don't know, like 50 billion bullets or something, 5 billion bullets. I don't know. That's why you don't have any bullets, by the way.
Yep.
All hollow points. So they were all being made for them. That's why you can't get ammo. But anyway, that's the reason why. The government made up all the ammo. And they bought all the ammo. So, I mean, the IRS has, I mean, you know, like health inspectors and people like that, they all come, when they pass those laws and everything, they come in and they do it at the force of a gun. Like, you have to understand, everything you think, oh, that sounds like a great law, does it? Like, just remember that it's enforced at the end of a sword. In this case, the end of a gun.
You will be equal.
Right? Every law. Yeah. That's how it works. So it's dangerous to do that over men's consciences. Very dangerous. Leonidas, Eurysicus, Macarius, Paulus, and Tyrannus, and Romanus were the persecutors. Sounds like all a bunch of lettuce, doesn't it? It does. Sounds like lettuce, like, right?
I did say Leonidas. Who did this? Leonidas.
That's right. Why are you talking again? And Romanius were the persecutors specifically named by the Donatists in Numidia, and Bagni is the principal town they have named for their effusion of their blood. But of none of their persecutors have they complained so much as of Macarius, for the defense of whom all sorts of arguments have been employed by the Catholics, especially Optatus and Augustine. So Augustine tried to defend the guy for, you know, nice guy. How many of the Donatists were killed in this war or were banished by the civil authorities? We have no information. In all Catholic descriptions, there is apparently a studied silence on this subject. Oh, I wonder why. Why would the Catholics do that? Why wouldn't they report that? That's weird. Optatus merely says some were slain and others were banished. All the deaths doubtless were affected by the armed force above described. So notorious was this war that the Donatists referred to it by simply naming it the Macarian Times. And those concerned in it or upheld it, they called Macarians. These terms with which the Catholics were exceedingly reproachful. So the Catholics hated that. So these Donatists called them, you're a bunch of Macarians is what you are. And that would be like, that would like enrage them. It would make them, those Catholics mad because they knew the reproach of that name because they had a murderous spirit. Yeah. Or calling somebody from the South a Yankee. Or them calling us Yankees. They mean something by that, right? They do. They mean something by that. You know, it bothers them. It's a term that's very charged. You know, it was a very charged term. These terms with the Catholics were exceedingly reproachful. Of this whole transaction, we have no information from the Donatists themselves. None of their writings on this subject have come down to us, which would doubtless present a very different view of this cruel and terrible war. Yeah, if you could hear from them, you would have heard a lot more information. Now, we are going to, not today, obviously, but we are going to get into their actual trials where they defend themselves. And that's going to, I think you'll like that. But unhappily for the memory of this people, the true and real history of this ancient affair will never be made public. We'll never have most of the information. All right. Well, we will stop right there, I think. And for sake of time here, I'm going to stop right there. And I'll pick this back up and more next week. You have your verses to memorize, right? John 16, 1 through 4. All right. And my question for you, a couple questions here. What was the Macarian War? So who was involved in the Macarian War, right? The Macarian War. This man Macarian, he was a Catholic, and he was hired by the emperor, okay, which was Constans, I believe, the emperor, and he was hired to reunite the Donatists with the Catholic Church. Okay, so that's who he was. So that's your question: is who is he? Also, what was the term that the Donatists called the Catholics that was a reproach to them? There's that one too. We'll ask you. All right. And as a bonus, if you can remember, what Bible story did the Makarians try to use to defend the killing of the Donatist? Right? So what Bible story did they try to use? There was a couple of them, but what Bible story? We'll see if you're paying attention. Did they use to try to defend the killing of the Donatists? All right? So those will be good. We'll get going on those, and then we'll pick up next week. More. We'll actually get into a little bit of Augustine and what he did to the Donatists, and then how the Donatists were favored by Julian, the apostate, which is going to be interesting. We'll talk about that. Why would this apostate this apostate emperor favor them? And we'll explain why. He did, and why they received liberty under him. And for a short time that was. Anyway, all right, let's pray. Father, Lord, thank you so much. Thank you for our rich history that we have. Thank you for the Bible. Thank you for God's holy word. Thank you that it explained that all these things were going to come to pass. We see them throughout history, and we see them today. Lord, just use this time in our lives, in our family, in our homes, in our church, be with every single person here, strengthen their hearts and lives. Make us fruitful for you this week. Thank you for these children. Thank you for their attention. Thank you for their listening. We love them, Lord. We're grateful that you've given us all these children. And we pray they'd know how much they mean to us, Lord, and how much they would know how much that they mean to you. And Lord, may we point them to Christ every day. Strengthen our church family, our body, be with us this week as we serve you and live for you. Help us to go out and fight the good fight of faith and lay hold on eternal life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.